Hey everyone, Buggy here. Obviously this episode is out way later than it should be. I apologize for that. Things happened, life got in the way, couldn't really help it. All I can really do is offer an apology and say, well, hey, better late than never, right? Just a reminder that the Digicast does contain some strong language and will contain spoilers for pretty much all of the adventure continuity just due to the nature of what we're covering. So, listener discretion is advised. Enjoy the show. Hey, what's up, superstars? Welcome back to the Digicast. I'm Buggy.
I'm Tom.
I'm Chris.
I'm Mad.
And we are determined to try to bring you the best Digimon content on the internet. We're obviously going to fail at that, though.
I refuse to comment on that pun.
Well, the keywords are both try and determination.
Oh, you motherfucker.
Tom, why do you never catch these?
Why do I never catch it?
You should just expect these from now on.
I should.
So we're going to be talking about Digimon Adventure Tri Part 2, Ketsui or Determination.
Yep.
Hey. Oh, man. This
spoiler,
was an episode.
Spoiler.
Yeah.
Indeed, lots of those.
Yeah, there's going to be spoilers. Like
one of them is not really a spoiler.
Yeah, you just kind of figured
it's kind of like a Sean Bean movie at that.
Leomon dies, guys.
What?
Were you expecting that at all?
I mean, I started that whole thing with, like, I really hope Leomon doesn't die this time.
I was expecting to at least make, nope. We're gonna at least make it to the next segment of Try. Come on.
I was like, I wonder how long till they off him. Oh wait, that was really fast.
Yeah, no, at this point, right. I think they've kind of written themselves into a corner where people are expecting them to kill Leomon. So they're just
poor
like, let's go ahead and get it out of the way instead of letting
people
fucking
by their internal logic of the series, they offed him for good, though.
Maybe. I don't know. That's kind of... We'll,
yeah, that's
we'll get to it when
point.
We get to that point in the story.
Because... Yeah, we should probably start from the beginning. So the beginning is that Ogremon, our good friend, is now running rampant.
He's infected.
Like something's up with him.
And once more, the episode opens with, I say episode, but like the movie opens with this very deep, meaningless sounding exposition as we... see these egg imageries. There seems to be a really strong egg theme running through the... Because, like, that's the first thing we're seeing in...
Now, here's the question.
Movies.
Is the exposition as meaningless as Phantom Worlds?
I'm cutting that out. I'm not talking about Phantom World in this podcast.
Welcome to the Digicast, where we refuse to speak about certain other anime. Sorry.
I guess Digi-Eggs, it's always kind of, Digimon's always kind of been like, Digi-Eggs are always kind of like the circle.
That was actually a good analogy, you were going for the...
Life and death, it's a circle of life and death, pretty much.
Well, in adventure, at least.
Because you die, you turn into an egg, and then you're born again.
Lather, rinse, repeat.
Yeah, exactly.
What happens if your egg gets smashed? Is that, like, the end of it?
Well, thankfully we never
Or is it like
there.
With us when Digimon die in the real world, does their data just sort of float around?
Well, that's a question we need to answer because we may have three. So but so, anyway.
Yep, Ogremons wrecking people's shit in the digital world.
And then we cut to the real world, and it's not really clear how much time has passed between the end of part one and the beginning of part two.
I'm guessing not all that long.
Not all that long, but at the same time, it seems like a little bit has passed. Maybe? Yeah, that's what I was figuring, like somewhere along that line.
Mm-hmm. And Mimi has organized a trip to the onsen for them all.
Because we needed some filler.
Because we needed fan service.
And oh gosh, there's fan service in many different ways
May got some fan service. I think she appreciated it.
We'll get to that. The first thing I've written down here is just Mimi's hat in all caps.
Yay!
She's wearing a pink cowboy hat again, and it's not the oversized one that's like half as big as her entire body if you actually look at it. It's much more realistically sized.
Yeah, she was pretty much wearing her exact outfit from the original series.
Mm-hmm.
Like, she had the pink dress, she had the hat.
TK and Izzy's fashion sense are...
I'm just waiting for TK to show up wearing, like, a tank top and having an earring.
For me, TK's outfit, compared to the previous parts, was actually pretty down.
Wait, what?
It wasn't as outrageous hipster as the ones from the previous episode of Try.
I guess not.
Yeah, granted, TK's attire gets better throughout the rest of this segment. Izzy's...
I mean...
He looks good in a bow tie. I mean,
over here we see the 11th Doctor.
No, the third, actually. He makes a good third Doctor.
No, that outfit was definitely a lot.
Oh, sorry, I confused numbers. The second, actually.
Oh, maybe, yeah. Second one, probably. Anyway, so we go to a day spa.
Welcome to the Digicast, where we talk about Doctor Who.
Oh, yeah.
Can we not?
Yes.
So, this episode has, well, at least this part has a lot of fan service, as you said, but it's mostly for, like, the ladies, oddly enough.
Yeah, that's the really weird thing. They go to the onsen and they do the whole entering the wrong side of the onsen plot, but they do it with the girls entering the guy's side, and they give them a reason to rather than just having them accidentally enter it.
Yeah, because they're looking for Palmon and that other little thing whose name I can never pronounce.
Meikumon.
Right.
Yeah, and there's like a really interesting thing that I noticed, and that's that when they're in the girls' baths, you hear them speaking, but the camera doesn't focus on them at all.
No, there's like no fan service for the dudes at all.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm wondering,
but not the way you'd expect it.
And what I'm wondering is this something that maybe Crunchyroll cut out because they had to for like
nope.
Nope. No, that's in, like, that was in the theatrical release and everything, too.
I would imagine so. I don't see a point of cutting it out.
Yeah.
No, but I don't think it was anything, I don't think anything was cut out because, well, I didn't
I get mean, the if they were going to cut anything out, they would probably just cut out Ty's awesomely toned packs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because,
I mean, Nishikawa fans get...
I mean, I'm just wondering if, like, there was potentially... actual nudity in there that Crunchyroll couldn't show due to censorship
like
and stuff
the
or whatever.
Japanese nope. Of season one.
Andy, we get it. You're still bitter.
Will you actually see like 11-year-old dong hanging out?
Oh, speaking of season one and callbacks, you get this scene where the girls are all in the sort of changing room together. And Mimi's stripping the Digimon, and is trying to strip all the people, but Gomamon's hanging out with there too, with them too, because we forgot to mention that Joe is absent on this trip. He's too busy to make it. But Gomamon's with them, and he's hanging out on the girls' side of the bath, which he did before, because they throw him over the wall in that first season.
Oh, this time they seem perfectly okay with it.
Yeah, they do.
Although, we have to make note of the line where Mimi says, let me strip you, girl.
Because we wanted to market this for a child version.
Of course they did.
I mean, when I was doing my tweet thing, and I was just, we got the bit, I'm just like, I'm just going to let that line speak for itself.
Bitch just thinks really she's nothing. An anime character.
There's really nothing I can add here that can add to this experience.
Except maybe, you know, you spin me around.
In any
song.
Other
right
scenario,
round, baby.
Nishikawa should have been fucking fired. Hanging out with a bunch of students
probably.
In the onsen.
Well, they weren't going to report him.
That's not creepy. And
I mean, he was there with his ex. You know, it was okay.
Like. There's a difference.
And some creepy government dudes.
Like, profession, I guess you should say. Should teachers be allowed to do that?
Well, in this case, he wasn't really their teacher. He was their liaison person thing, whatever the fuck he is.
Caseworker?
Sure, let's go with that.
I'm pretty sure that something like that would be completely acceptable in Japanese culture. It's there. They just happen to be at the same public baths together. These are public baths, Chris. Like, you realize that you're gonna be seeing a bunch of other strangers naked, and potentially friends and people that you know naked.
I guess, but you know...
That's how these work.
The sake for a pedophilia joke is...
But it's not pedophilia. Bathing is
not
sexual.
I know, but
sexual.
I will take any advantage to make one that I
okay,
can.
So maybe we should move past this.
Yeah.
Okay, but... Completely aside from that, that joke would be hard to sell because Nishikawa
that
looks barely older than they do.
One thing I really need to point out about this episode is that there were a lot of moments where they were trying to build up some kind of tension, and it didn't pay out, and like there wasn't any, like, nothing bad happened. It was just an average day out.
Actually, when we get to the end of episode 4, there is one little bit of instance that I think might have something to do with it.
Yeah, I think I know what Chris is talking about, but
let's
go on
so
with the filler.
Yeah, it's just there were so many moments where like Michimon.
So Gabumon
around.
Gets stripped.
Oh yeah, that's right. Gabumon takes off his
not
his
by
pelt.
His free will, mind
pelt.
You.
Yeah.
Then Biamon and Meikumon are playing around and end up getting.
Oh, no, it's Biomon and Meikumon.
Yeah,
right.
They climb into a like a place for towels to get washed and such. And they that thing gets taken out by a cleaning lady. And so they have to sort of try to get back to the others.
And as callbacks go, they were pretending to be stuffed animals.
Stuffed
yep.
animal.
Because it's worked for them so far. You know, if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
And so they have to enter the wrong side of the onsen in order to find them because they're able to, like someone mentions, seeing them in the men's side.
And shenanigans ensue.
Yep, Mimi distracts all the men by bursting in and singing to them. Which
the singing the ending
yep.
theme to Adventure Zero One.
Yep.
She used to have a better handle on that song.
Yeah, it was almost like she had a different voice actor.
I get it.
But yeah, the Sakari fans get their fan fictions fueled.
There was so many things for those two in this
episode.
Oh
gosh, it's great. And one thing I want to notice is like as Mei and Sora are running through there. Mei runs into a guy who's got the towel on his head. That dude's completely naked, and you can see that Mei doesn't know how to deal with this, and that's why Sora just drops the bucket down over her head. And then we get the great great moment where Mei runs into Tai shows up there, and they're like he asks them what they're doing in there, and. Mei's like, I can't see anything. See, my glasses are all fogged up. See?
And then she looks
then she
down
forward and looks down.
Because
and Ty is just like
I do like what
and
I do
Digimon
like.
Adventure 3 was
just
bad.
Slowly close the door.
I'm used to that.
Matt, of all people, should be used to it.
Yeah.
Used to what?
Do I correctly remember that Digimon was marketed to a children's audience?
I gotta say, Matt and Ty in the sauna together, it was very much like a yes.
Yes, I was expecting them to like stay in, you know, have a sort of a silent competition to see who can hold out the longest.
Well, with those two, I mean,
they would die.
But there's so much. Again, there's so much shipping fuel between those two for this.
Oh my god, this episode was so gay.
It really was so gay.
I think it's the gayest I've ever seen Digimon.
Oh yeah, Izzy drops his little shower thing when he sees them. we do learn that Nishikawa and what's her name? Himekawa?
I think, maybe.
I don't remember.
I think it was Himekawa, but basically they used to date.
And they've known each other since high school.
Yep.
It is Himekawa, Maki Himekawa.
Nishikawa and Himekawa. That's funny.
Wasn't it?
Nishijima? Oh, Nishijima. Sorry. Oh,
Nishijima.
God.
Yep. We're so professional.
You guys know Japanese names better than I do.
All right. So, then, what we see is Ogremon showing up in the real world
with the military prepared to meet him,
and they fucking lay into him like. They actually shot a Digimon, yo.
With guns. Yeah. Real guns. That shoot bullets.
Yeah, didn't do anything.
Real bullets.
And then they used blasters.
And it still didn't work. Because apparently Ogremon's made out of fucking titanium.
Mm-hmm.
Or plot.
Oh yeah, that's the other thing. They now can figure out the general area where a Digimon's going to show up.
So that kind of puts the goggles thing out of... They don't really need the goggles.
Well, Brand, again, it's just the general area, so I guess the goggles.
Oh, yeah, true.
And then do we want to just move right on to the school segment with the committee?
Yeah, because it's Mimi doing what Mimi does best, taking charge.
And this is...
Yeah!
This is, like, I think that the onsen thing is kind of helpful because it establishes Mimi's character and Mako's character a little bit more. This is really where it kicks that up.
Yep.
Because... Mimi and Mako are on a school festival committee together, and Mimi is, I think she's one of the younger
Mimi
people.
Volunteers.
Yeah, she's one of the younger people in there, but she volunteers. And
Mimi
to run the cafe.
A cafe that's not Hooters.
Totally not Hooters.
I was about to say, like, they basically, totally not Hooters.
Yeah, exactly, not Hooters.
Totally not Hooters. Where did you get that idea?
This is Daters. It's something completely
totally
different.
Totally different.
It's the PG version. The PG version of Hooters. I've never been to a Hooters. We have one where I am. I've never been to it.
We don't have them here, so...
Well, yeah, but over there, like...
No. Is there even a Polish equivalent?
I think
no, not really.
I mean, isn't prostitution legal over there? Like...
Don't get me started on talking on Polish prostitution laws. It's a black. There could be a whole you know other podcast about it. But Hooters isn't prostitution. It's just
no.
As far as I understand, it's a fast food restaurant with a sexy dress code,
basically,
and busty server.
Yep. But it's totally not Hooters. It's a thing called Daters, where they wear revealing cheerleading outfits. Totally different thing.
And totally awesome.
Pretty much the entire committee is like, but nobody.
And then the Mimi's like,
nobody offers a better
Mimi's
solution.
Like, yeah!
No, nobody wants to step up and be like, that's a fucking stupid idea.
Nope.
Well, it's not a stupid idea necessarily, but nobody really wants to do it, but they don't want to step up. So it gets passed. Mimi and Mako go to, you know, check out fabric and material for making the outfits and whatnot.
We get the new variant of Digimon, Geisha Palamon.
Yeah, I was like, wow, the racism alarms is kind of...
You can't, I'll be honest here, because you can't really cry racism over Japanese people making, using Japanese culture comedically.
Yeah, it's not nearly as bad as Reggae Palmon back in season one.
Oh dear.
Hey man, yeah. I'm Reggae Palmon. It's tough being a plant type Digimon who's into reggae. I want to smoke myself all the time.
Oh god!
I'm so confused.
There's a point in season one where I think they're sneaking into Myotismon's castle, is what they're doing.
Oh yeah.
So there's I think punk rock Agumon and Reggae Palmon that they dress up.
That's
as.
Right. I remember that. That was actually the second episode I ever watched.
How do you know that?
Because I remember the day I discovered Digimon.
Oh, okay.
The first one was Sora's Crest, and the second one was the one immediately after, a.k.a. that one. And then I started from the beginning.
Okay.
Yep.
And then it all went downhill.
And then my life went downhill, yes.
Oh yeah, fair note. Even though Meikumon is an adult Digimon, acts a lot like a child.
Excuse me, because that's one thing I wanted to point out, because I'm weirded out by the translation, because they have the Western version, Digimon names, but then they go for Japanese version level descriptions, so instead of, rookies and champions, they go for child and adult.
Yeah. And the thing is, knowing those things makes a lot of sense, because if you listen to the rookies speak, or the child Digimon speak, they sound like children, like young children. Whereas if you listen to Gatomon speak, or Tailmon, she has a much more adult voice.
She
and
does, yeah.
That threw me when I first started listening to the sub, just how much older she sounds than all the others, because she's an adult-level Digimon.
Yeah, well, she's champion. Even in the dub, when her voice didn't sound exactly adult, she still had very adult mannerisms as opposed to several of the other mons.
I guess, yeah. But yeah, that's something that threw me. And Meikumon sounds very much like a child, despite allegedly being an adult-level Pokemon. Digimon, goddammit.
Goddammit!
That thing always... Meikumon, I always mispronounce that name in one form. I always either misspell it or I mispronounce it.
I think because... I think Meikumon's powers center about adorability, as, is seen later.
What else? What happens next? I'm trying to remember.
Well, Ogremon shows... before that, Mimi and Mako bond over the fact that Mako is good with art and fashion design and such. And that's when Mimi and Mako start to get really, really gay together. And then
this whole movie was gay.
Oh, it was. It was. It was fantastically gay.
It was amazingly gay.
Like, as a straight person, I say, this was so gay and I loved it.
Also, it should be worth pointing out, May is from the sticks.
Yes. She is near that village where Matt and TK were in the movie.
The one with no computers.
I love how bitter
Ty is. Actually, Ty and Matt are still pretty salty at each other throughout this whole thing.
A little bit. I think they're starting to kind of, not for a while even. They're still just kind of pretty about it.
Yeah, we should really gloss over that, because there's obviously some tension between them, and they're talking about how, that's probably a large part of why Omegamon split up while they were fighting Alphamon.
But, you know, a large part of the why Matt is salty is the fact that Omegamon split up when they were fighting.
Well, yeah, but it's creating just more of this divide between the two of them. And that's, it's mostly sort of a background thing that's going on, because the focus this episode is on Mimi and on Joe. But
yes, it is.
Yep.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
But I like how, you know, they're sort of keeping these guys in mind, and they'll be sort of developing them more gradually as everyone else receives their character development, which is always something Digimon does well, except in some of the seasons.
Yeah. But that's always something I've always admired about the show, is how it does that with its characters.
Yep. But anyway, getting back to the plot, Ogremon shows up at that point.
And Mimi decides to go after him.
Yep, she says, no, I'm not gonna just sit by. I'm going to charge ahead and not wait for the others, and use Togemon to take down Ogremon on my own.
But not delete it, because they're still...
Exactly, like, yeah. You remember the camaraderie they once shared.
Yeah.
But at the same, time, it's like, they know Ogremon by now. They know they can take Ogremon.
Yeah.
Yeah, but, yeah. And Mimi's charging in there also largely because she wants to, you know, make it publicly seen that there are Digimon that will, you know, be fight for the good
yeah,
in the world.
She wants to visibly be the good guy.
It doesn't quite work out that
yeah.
way.
Yeah, Togemon uses its 10,000 needles attack.
Which is a massive AoE.
She ends up crashing this chopper with no survivors.
God, you and your Bane posting, I swear.
You merely adopted Bane posting. I was born into it.
Fuck.
Molded by it.
God, that is terrible. That is...
I swear, if we ever meet, I'm going to kick your ass, Andy.
I'm going to hold him down while you do it.
Just, oh, it's so good to finally meet you!
The thing you guys are... The scenario you're setting up is disturbingly like a really messed up porno.
We weren't gonna tell you right now, but... anyway. So...
Yes, anyway.
Meikumon shows her fighting prowess.
Joe doesn't show up to the call.
Again.
Yeah, again.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Joe just can't deal.
I know. I feel so bad for Joe this episode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Then in the aftermath, Izzy ends up being the one to call Mimi out. Says that, you know, she has a bit of an egocentric side.
Which, you mean?
Yep.
We always knew she did.
Yeah.
It's not exactly new information.
Point is, this time it... kind of big time, led to a kind of big time screw up, and yeah, Meikumon showed us that
it's like she needed to be called out for what happened in a lot of ways, but at the same time, maybe then wasn't the time.
Maybe not, but at the same time, it kind of is going along with Tri's message this time around. Its consequences, again, we're seeing it. You know, Mimi does what she normally does, and this time it backfired in a big way. And you see the negative repercussions of that.
And it's Izzy, of all people, that chews her out about.
Well, Izzy was Izzy could be counted upon to, you know, lay down the truth bombs when it was needed.
Yeah, but, you know, the also one of the, you know, side points in Try is that Izzy has a humongous crush on Mimi. Yeah. So the fact that he, you know, pushes that aside to chew her out... is kind of
because Mimi is his friend first. Like, he's known her for a very long time at this point.
Also, let's just point out Japan once again making the hot-headed character who does not think and who will jump into jump into situations and be loud and obnoxious and egocentric. Let's just point out that that's the American character again.
Yeah,
I was kind of expecting. I was for a second there. I was kind of expecting you to say that Mimi is the Davis of Kai.
Oh God, no!
No, oh,
no. Don't even joke about that.
That's not even funny.
Ty of all people sticks up for Joe.
Yeah. Well, Ty used to stick up for Joe.
Compared to Adventure Try. Adventure Ty.
Well, I mean, but there were several moments in the original where Ty stuck up for Joe.
Maybe the better phrase is early adventure.
That's definitely a lot better, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, because Ty's going thinking of the exact same thing, probably. But then Leomon shows up, and then somehow he comes to talk to them.
Yeah.
I don't know how he's making the port. I don't know how he got through on his own without an evil portal, but he did.
Plot.
Exactly.
I don't know. Apparently there's been a lot popping up.
So. Yeah, true. Plot. We'll go with plot.
Mm-hmm.
And then Ogremon just kind of fades from the story at that point.
Yeah,
he's Leomon just kind of throws him back into the digital world.
So. Knocks him out.
Speaking of which, they still haven't gone to the digital world. I wonder if that's happening at all.
I think
they might have a boss fight there at some point.
Probably.
Yeah, they're probably going to have to. Because, I mean, if the enemy's not going to come out here, then they got to go in there for him.
Oh, we completely forgot to mention something in the opening and a little background thing here.
Ah, yes.
The Digimon Emperor is back.
Yeah, Ken is back as the Emperor.
Yep.
Somehow.
We can't be sure it's Ken, you know, it's the masking outfit. It could be someone posing as him.
Who could it be?
The outfit is aesthetically different.
Everyone seems to recognize him upgrade. As Ken Ichijooji.
Jesus Christ.
Also, the glasses, the Myotismon symbol's been replaced.
Yeah.
So.
But the thing of the matter is, like, if it's not Ken, then who is it?
Who indeed?
Because, like, if you're going to introduce a new dude, you kind of have to, you know, build up to him, you know?
There's a lot of questions surrounding.
But didn't we? I'm pointing this out because didn't we see Ken obliterated along the rest
of the
Zero Two curve?
We saw something bad happen to him. Yeah.
We just kind of saw them fall backwards with a flash of light.
Yeah, it could not even be Ken acting of his own will.
Oh no, probably not.
Yeah,
it's probably whatever got Alphamon to do his bad thing. Or we maybe don't even need to assume.
We're not at this point sure if Alphamon was actually doing a bad thing.
We don't even know if Alphamon and Ken are, you know, working the same shtick on this one. Like they could be two completely different sides here.
And they could both be like well meaning in what they're doing.
Maybe.
Like motivations all over the board are pretty vague right now. We know what the Digidestined are doing, and their reasoning is pretty much just, well, these things are coming through these portals and trying to attack other things, and we're gonna try to stop them.
But what's causing it? And I actually, me and my buddy Chad, we got into a very large discussion in regards to, well, maybe we could probably talk about this later towards the end of the episode, but about Alphamon and the enemy at the end of this episode, which I guess I won't spoil too much just yet.
But yeah.
We'll get to that when we get to that. Let's just move right along.
You know, Mimi's still upset about the whole fact that Izzy's calling her selfish, and on top of that, the girls at the school are like, this whole cheerleader thing, we're not doing that.
But before that scene, there is one moment with Mimi that I absolutely adore.
What was that?
She hears those kids talking about her, and she's just like, "Say it to my face."
Oh God, yeah.
And I'm just like, "I love you." I didn't appreciate you enough.
Because apparently everyone recognizes her on the camera, but the cops do nothing about it. So,
but what would the cops charge her with? Assault by way of giant monster?
I'm just like, Mimi, I didn't appreciate you enough as a kid. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Now I'm older and I understand more.
Mimi is best girl.
You are the best. Yes, she is best girl.
Indeed.
So these girls, they refer to Mimi as being Jikochu. I think the term is.
Yeah.
That they
use.
Which
means what?
Which means like.
It basically means. Basically, what happened there? It basically means she's self-centered, and it's a kind of in terms of translation, it's kind of a Keikaku means plan moment because the word is like semi-obscure in Japanese, so she needs it explained, or perhaps it's like a slang version of it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, you know, it's explained as very something very, very fucking simple. As they describe it, it basically amounts to self-centered.
Yeah.
I mean, so, they kind of ran into...
Everything went according to Keikaku.
They kind of ran into an issue there where she needed it explained and sort of translated for her. But then, like, they either have to, you know, ignore the word recurring after that point or... leave it untranslated like that. It's an unfortunate translation issue that they were sort of forced into, I think.
Yeah.
Plays much better in Japanese, I think.
Probably, yeah. And then we get to probably the best moment in the entire film.
Mm-hmm.
With Mimi and Joe.
Yep, where they just...
stand together in the rain and talk.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, I love the fact that it was Mimi and Joe, because those two, for better or for worse, have always had some kind of an understanding with each other.
Have they? Is it just that they have their evolutions around the same general time?
I feel like they do understand each other better than most of them.
There's also the, you know, there's also the fact that both of their like inner conflicts, like focus Mimi's in the original adventure, and Joe's now got focused on the fact that they're asking why is it us, why do we have to fight this.
Mm-hmm.
That there's a thematic consistency there.
And Joe just has this absolutely fantastic line where he's talking about how, you know, he thought that he was over this question. He thought, you know, he had figured out and come to an understanding on why he had to fight and why, you know, he can't be a coward and run away. But he says, you know, even if I've had those answers, those things answered and come to an understanding and have come to deal with that in the past, I still keep coming back to the same questions.
And that's such a real life answer.
Yeah.
Because, like, yeah, you have it figured out at one point, but then you change, you age, and your experiences change.
And the world and changes. Suddenly,
and that answer is no longer applicable.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, oh my, I've rarely related to so much in my life then I relate to this quote.
You did state on, I think it was on your Facebook, that you relate to the cast of Adventure Try now much more than you related to them as a kid.
I understand it because I've been there. Like, these last 3 or 4 years that I've been out of college, like, it's just you keep asking those same questions.
Yeah, and I think the pairing of Joe and Mimi there is also, you know, something that works really well because they're foils for each other. Mimi's issue is that she's egocentric and abrasive and is always charging in, whereas Joe's is that he's passive and he's cowardly and he's running away. And, you know, Joe tells her at one point, as she's working through her own problems, you know, better to be jikochu
Better to be egocentric.
Yeah, better to be egocentric than a coward.
Yeah, and poor Joe, my God, like, he breaks down more than once over the course of this movie, and it just breaks your fucking heart.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
Like, I just want to hug him.
It's not,
especially when Gomamon decides that he can't deal anymore.
Yeah. And also the fact that we meet Joe's parents for the first time.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
We've never.
Yeah, I do like how they treat Gomamon like a little sibling. Sibling Joe's doing his work, honey.
Yeah, but I love the fact that even though the parents are obviously they want him to do the best, I don't really get that feeling like because Joe Dad said like I want him to do his best. Like that's all he says.
Yeah.
Like he doesn't really. It's not like really a crack the whip kind of thing.
I think the thing is though, Joe's the sort of person who doesn't like to disappoint people. And yeah. even if they yeah. wouldn't be as disappointed as he thinks he would, he still, like, whenever he fails himself, he feels like he's letting himself down and he's letting everyone else around him down in the process.
Yeah, exactly what I was about to say. So it's like, you gotta wonder how much of this is just him piling this on himself. Yeah,
and I know that, you know, I've often felt the same way about a lot of things. I feel like, you know, if there's someone who sees my potential and recognizes the potential, you know, if I'm not doing my best, I'm disappointing them as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is nice we get to see Joe's parents. I'm a little...
No sign of Jim, though.
Yeah, I'm disappointed we didn't get to see Joe's brother Jim and his other brother Jim.
Actually, when you think about it, the dub canon would make this even harder on Joe, because you know the family wanted a doctor, but since Joe only has one brother in this, and that brother wanted to be a doctor but dropped out to study folklore, it's a bit heavier on Joe.
That's very true. That is very true.
Mm-hmm. And then Kari's just randomly there for some reason.
Yeah, I never really understood why Kari was there, because, like, Kari didn't...
So she could give Joe the pep talk in part four.
It's...
Yeah. You know, but Kari... it's at the same time, it's like, Kari and Joe, or Kari and Mimi, never really interacted all that much.
Yeah, I think what's gonna happen is this will be a bit more clear as we'll see things go on and see sort of what Kari's role in the story ends up being.
She'll be Jesus again.
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty much.
Oh, Jesus, Kari. that should just be the new, like, a new, like, say thing you ever say. Like, Jesus, Kari!
I gotta give credit to dub acting for a second. I know this hasn't been dubbed, but whenever Gomamon talks, I just instinctively hear R. Martin Klein's voice.
Who? Oh, Gomamon?
Dub Gomamon. Yeah. I think it just shows how good a job the Gomamon dub was, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Kind of, those two just match personalities so
well. Gomamon could always be counted upon to, like, give Joe a smack upside the head when he needed it.
Yeah.
Even though he doesn't do, I don't think Gomamon was. It seemed not to have the right effect this time around, like it used to.
Yeah.
I mean, the little guy tried, obviously.
Yeah.
But I think in addition to Joe going, I think Gomamon's also kind of grown up. Because he's kind of a bit more reserved now.
I don't know. I'm not sure I would say so.
Yeah, it feels like it.
I think the thing is, in the past, like, Joe and Gomamon are together as partners, not because they amplify each other, but because they complement each other.
Yeah.
And Gomamon's there to sort of pull Joe through what he needs to get through and give him that push. But the thing is, Joe has to be putting forth the effort as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Joe has been pretty much for most of Try has been at his desk, you know, refusing to actually enter combat, except that a few situations. And Gomamon says it himself. He wants to fight, but he can't do it without Joe.
Yeah, and Joe is either unable or unwilling to commit.
He mustn't run away. He mustn't run away. He mustn't run away.
Oh, God. God damn it.
Please don't.
Get in the fucking robot, Joe.
Look, I'm never going to make the Shinji Ikari comparison to Joe, because Shinji is a little bitch.
Shinji is goddamn 14.
Yeah, and Joe is, what, 16 at this point?
Okay, no. Like, seriously, Shinji was an orphan who was pulled out of his relatively safe environment by his asshole dad and told to mount a war machine.
Evangelion.
Hey, you only dislike Evangelion because you watched it wrong.
I watched it wrong. I watched it and then I drank and then I forgot about it.
Evangelion's a series that you really have to work. Like you have to work in order to understand it and appreciate it, but once you're able to, like, there's a lot of really great
assuming
stuff
you don't
there.
Put a gun in your mouth first. Anyway,
it's not even a robot. Yeah, back to Digimon.
Yeah, so there's a festival that happens.
Yes.
Oh wait, before that, Izzy gets an email.
Oh yes. Some fucking Chuni sends him an email.
Yes, two sides of the universe are like two sides of the same coin. Those who desire true power must know the darkness and go beyond.
Darko endo darko.
So that goes to another thing that I discussed with my friend that we'll talk about towards the end. But we also noticed the fact that little triceratop motherfucker was hanging around underneath their window. Listening in.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Regarding that email.
Hackmon, yeah, that's what I was told was his name.
Regarding that email.
Oh, Hackmon or
Hackmon?
Hackmon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Regarding that email, when thinking about it later, one of my primary thoughts, well, not primary, but more prominent thoughts was, but Yukio Oikawa is dead.
Who?
Oikawa.
Oh, Oikawa, right, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so the festival happens, and the Digimon want to go, and there's this, the most adorable thing I've ever seen in my life happens.
Yeah, because Meikumon convinces Leomon to take them there with the power of adorable.
Yes. Papa Leomon, can we go have fun, Papa Leomon?
And see, for a bit, I didn't know whether or not Meikumon was male or female. Like, I had to actually look this up. So, like, for a while,
gender doesn't matter when something's funny.
I guess it doesn't, but, like, you see his heart, like, exploding out of his chest. And there I was kind of vaguely under the impression that Meikumon might be male, so I was like... Is Leomon legitimately gay for Meikumon?
No, I think it was just too cute. I think that's all it was. It was just too cute for him.
Like puppies.
Yeah. But anyway, then what happens is Leomon puts on the most ridiculous outfit to
They're gonna let that guy walk around
isn't that the basic Ninja Turtle disguise?
No, that's the disguise you wear when you want to get the police called on you when you go to a little kid's school.
So yeah, the basic Ninja Turtle disguise, a trench coat.
I mean, like he's wearing this pink beret type hat. He's wearing a cravat. He's wearing
Skull Merrimon's coat because hey, Skull Merrimon's not gonna need it anymore.
I was gonna say Dick Gumshoe's coat. From the Ace Attorney series.
Oh my god.
Well, here's the thing. That is actually Leomon's ultimate form, Sketchy Leomon, which comes before Boncho Leomon.
Well, now we know.
I believe that the dub translated it as Pedo Leomon, though.
Oh my god. So, yeah. They let that guy wander around the school. And the Digimon get caught up in, what was it, like an ugly costume contest?
Ugly cute, I think. Creepy cute.
Yeah. Because they wanted food, but they didn't have money, so they entered the competition.
Yeah.
And then
Meikumon won.
Yeah, Meikumon
like
wins.
The kids are all running around, and they find the Digimon finally, and Meikumon wins.
And Matt's first response is, wait, why didn't Gomamon win?
Why didn't Gabumon win?
Gabumon wins.
And I'm like, Matt, is this really the pressing issue right now?
Oh, speaking of...
You know,
of,
he, has, He has pride, you know. He has pride riding on this, okay?
Yeah.
Speaking of Matt, his band plays.
Yep.
Only now.
What was it?
Only now it's Knife on the Ramen.
God damn it,
no,
Andy.
Not,
that joke will never take off, you know it.
No, it's Knife on the World.
Yeah, Chris, he knows this joke will never take off. He wants to keep us down with the joke.
Rolled on the knife.
Yeah. I actually did think it was Knife on the Ramen for a little bit.
God damn it.
Let's talk about the cafe.
No. Yes. Wait. I wanna stay on the band name for a bit because
oh Jesus fucking
like
Christ.
I've heard some people say that, you know, this is like just a sort of festival exclusive band that Matt's formed and they're still called Knife of Day. But I really just want there to be a joke where every time Matt's band is brought up he's changed the name again.
I think that's what they're going for, actually.
I really hope that that's what's happening here, because...
It seems like that's what they're going for.
I just love how Kari gives this long stare at TK mouthing the name as he
And TK gets, like, the tooth sparkle, too, as he grins at her.
And Kari's just like, TK, I love you, but no.
Yes, the cheerleading scene. The cafe scene.
Yeah. First, we need to point out that...
Nishijima and Himekawa came to the festival.
And now they managed to save the cheerleader thing, even though the other kids didn't want it.
Yeah, but they've got two cheerleaders rather than everyone being cheerleaders.
Yeah, so they got Mai and they got Mimi.
Mei.
And Mei, sorry. And Mei was the one, but we gotta give props to Mei because she was the one who kind of like turned it around because Mimi wanted to bail on the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And Mei, even though she's kind of like a really shy girl, she gets it going.
Yep.
It's like, okay. Good job, girl.
I think it's good to point out at this point that the organization for which the Nishijima and Himekawa work have gotten readings that there will be an anomaly around the school during the festival. So they place themselves on the festival. Mm-hmm.
Gosh, that must be really hard for Nishijima to infiltrate.
But basically, Nishijima muses, while they patrol, I guess, Nishijima muses on the fact that he'd like the Digidestined to actually, you know, have a moment of being kids, because that's who they are. And that's because that leads to Himekawa arriving at the cafe.
Let's actually before we get into the whole cafe before we get into that, I want to bring up sort of a theory that I started formulating around this point. And that's that the story that Tri is ultimately telling is the story of passing the torch. Because we've heard, you know, in the adventure continuity, you know, there were Digidestined that came before these kids.
Yes.
There are theories floating around as to who that could have been. Like, there are theories that TK and Matt's dad was one of them, I think.
That'd be interesting, actually.
But what I think maybe, like, the way that Himekawa and Nishijima are talking about things, I'm thinking potentially they may have been Digidestined in the past, and I think this story might be the story of, you know, these kids growing up, passing on the reins to the next generation of Digidestined.
Didn't they already kind of do that already?
With 02, you mean?
Yeah.
Yes and no.
Granted,
I don't think
the kids are kind of dead now, but...
Yeah, there's that. And I think that it's not...
I mean, there's also hundreds of other kids around the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's more of, like... There's more of a gap in terms of age there, I think.
Okay.
Well,
they better start introducing the new kids, like, soon, then, because...
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure if this is ultimately where it's going,
yeah.
But
I don't think it is.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
The only way I can really see this ending is, like, with the kids finally being able to be free of this burden and maybe taking on a different role, like Himikawa and Nishijima have done.
Well, yeah, Matt goes to outer space.
I will now.
Don't you fuck? You fucking stop right now.
I was going to make a more serious point, more serious leaning towards the, you know, ending of 02, because as Tri progresses, we get Digimon becoming, you know, more ever more publicly televised, people being aware and knowing about them. And one of the things that at least part of the main cast would like to happen is that people start getting on with the Digimon and not just instantly consider them a threat when they appear.
Yeah.
Which would lead to, you know, ultimately to the wish fulfillment of 02, that is, everybody gets a Digimon partner.
Mm-hmm. I think this is going to end with passing the torch, but I could be wrong.
We'll see.
I did realize why no one really seems to openly make a big deal about going back to the Myotismon incident and whatnot. Because upon the 02 rewatch, I was reminded that Genai goes out of his way to remove, to delete any public or withheld records regarding Digimon.
Yeah, they did that.
That's some Orwellian shit right there, Genai.
Shit.
Yeah. Maybe that's not Ken. Maybe that's evil Genai in Ken disguise.
Maybe Ken is possessed by Myotismon.
Oh my god!
Well, hey, the mark's not on his glasses anymore, so...
Anyway.
The cafe scene, probably one of the most awkwardly animated segments I have seen in a long time. From
a
anything.
Little bit. Toei show it, really showing that maybe not all their money is going to this. Maybe they're setting some stuff aside for Precure yet.
So much zoom, so many electric slides, so many.
It's a filler scene, guys.
But we got to the big thing about this scene, of course, is the fact that the lady sent a fucking picture of Mimi in a tight skirt to Izzy
and labeled it like important information or something along those lines.
That
and he reads
troll.
It instantly and goes like, "I need to be at the Skull Festival now.
Yes, because
I am dressed up for no related reason.
Yes, because I need to slip a $5 bill into her purse."
And he shows up with that face on his with that expression on his face, and he's just like, "I wear a bow tie now."
Bow ties are cool.
Find me cool.
Oh yeah,
Mimi.
Also with the cheerleading outfits, the kimono sash with the cheer. How successful is Sora's business in the future? I'm curious.
Magically successful. Oh. And Matt went into space.
God damn it, you guys. Although, let me point out here that the existence.
Matt went to space to get away from their crippling debt.
Oh my god, I'm buying that.
Jesus.
Is that also where he OD'd? That is so metal that he went to space to OD.
Oh my god.
Anyway, on the cheerleading scene, let me just point out that you remember in the dub of Digimon Adventure how Mimi was always talking about how she wanted to go to cheerleading camp instead. And there are a bunch of people who are like, this is, Mimi doesn't strike me as a cheerleader. Well, guess what? All the dubs' translations now are fucking justified. Not all their translations, but everything about Mimi going to cheerleader camp is fucking justified. Because she dresses up as a cheerleader as if she has gone to cheerleading camp.
Is that even
a
thing?
She wasn't good enough to get fully animated, so take that for what you will.
Rude.
Hey, she didn't go to animation camp.
Oh yeah, also a guest appearance by fucking Ryo.
Oh yeah, you saw that. Really? I don't know if that was really supposed to be him though.
Really?
The hair was a little shorter, but just my first
Wait,
reaction.
which episode was that?
Part 3?
Part 3 or part 4, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. When ish? Yeah, please do, because I'm like,
yeah, I didn't make the connection myself, but
I don't know, that was just my first instantaneous reaction. Is that fucking Ryo?
would that mean that he's back from Tame Metal's world?
I don't know, he seems to go in and out of everywhere.
Yeah. No, because, you know, he canonically went from Adventure Universe into Tamer's Universe.
Canonically, he's kind of a fucking fuck.
Yeah, I mean, like, he's an immortal coming through the portal. Stuck in a time loop from 2004, though. I don't know
why.
What you rhyme for, though.
Anyway.
Here we go, Matt.
Yeah. Thank you.
Doesn't matter, because I'm cutting, like, all this out. Not all of it.
No. Leave it.
Like, I'm leaving the Ryo thing, but the whole bit with you.
You leave the rap.
I need... I'm not sure. That actually could be Ryo.
Yeah, it does. It looks a lot like Ryo.
No, let me look at it again. Hang on. Yeah, I don't see it.
I need to do a side by side with, you know, a Tamer's image of Ryo. Okay, no. The eye color does not check out. Ryo has, oh, or does it? Because goddammit, in the Wonder Swan games, his eyes were brown, but in Tamer's, his eyes are blue, and.
I am great magician. Your eyes are
anyway,
blue.
Anyway, okay. Alright, back to the thing. So.
Yeah, please, Beck, sorry.
There's a cameo that may or may not be Ryo. And I guess we will
see.
Link an image and let you decide that for yourself.
Yeah. Okay. But.
But maybe that maybe that Digimon Emperor is Ryo.
Okay, now you're just stretching.
Maybe.
Yes,
maybe
actually, I'm sorry
Digimon
for that.
Digimon Emperor is Ryo fused with Myotismon.
Maybe the Digimon Emperor is you, and you were skeleton, and you wrote this!
Goddamn.
But who was phone?
Okay. So the Emperor shows up.
Yeah.
And it's
then new, is rocking a new version of the Digimon Emperor outfit, and I'm actually digging it.
And it's at this point that Kari finally realizes, wait a minute, has anyone actually heard from Davis and the others in the last week or so?
Do they actually bring this up? I don't
remember
them bringing it up.
No, but Kari, but TK is just like, is that Ken? And Kari just kind of puts her, puts her hand over her mouth. Like, kind of like one of those, like, oh god, did I leave the oven on kind of moments?
Yeah.
But instead it was just like, oh my god, where's Davis and the others? Davis hasn't stalked me in like 4 days.
Oh, oh god, that's terrible.
But interesting thing of note, Meikumon gets separated from Mei after being hypnotized by the King of Flan, and now wanting to fulfill her desire to eat Flan. Courage to Cowardly Dog reference, folks. And runs into Himekawa, who then brings him to the area where Ken shows up as she goes off to get Meikumon ice cream.
Yeah.
Intentional? Accidental? Who knows?
Well,
who knows?
Maybe
on,
her subconscious
yeah.
is being guided by Myotismon.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Maybe you should drop the Myotismon reference joke and go back to ramen.
Maybe Myotismon is the new front runner of teenage ramen.
Oh my god. So basically, Leomon gets attacked, like, by... Apparently Ken has completed Kylo Ren's training. Because he's apparently
second now. Oh, second Kylo Ren reference in two podcasts.
Actually, it's more like as if he's controlling the infections, because I understood that the what he did to Leomon was, you know, initiate the infection that makes the Digimon go berserk and try.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, that's what it looks like.
Yeah, no, that is what it looks like. But it just is like what has happened to Ken? What has happened to him? He is not the boy we once knew. This is not the boy who went on that 20 episode redemption arc.
Yeah, and I'm still pretty sure that's not Ken.
This is not the boy who had a Christmas party where Davis proposed strip poker.
But then who could it be? Himekawa looks at him and says, is that Ken Ichijooji? Although we can be pretty sure that they've never met.
Yeah, but I think...
Well, she has files on them.
Okay.
But at the same time, would it be? What other person do we... I think it would be really cheap if they just pulled some new guy out.
Yeah, and I think the kids themselves make references to thinking that it's Ichijooji.
Well, TK and Kari outright state that that's Ken. And I think of
But of the eight, they would know. I think they're still pulling that from the Emperor outfit. I mean, remember that in 02 when they didn't, you know, recognize him between the outfits.
But of they would know Ken.
And let's keep in mind, too, though, that...
He didn't speak a word, so we have no vocal.
Then who the fuck is it?
Digimon.
You're setting me up here, Tom. You don't want to set me up for another Myotismon reference.
What I'm saying is, I feel like it would be really cheap if they just pulled some new kid that we've never fucking heard of out of thin air to wear the Digimon Emperor's clothes.
I'm not even saying it's a new kid. It could be an Arugini monster.
Yeah, it could be, you know, a Digimon posing as humanoid.
Oh, that would be interesting.
We've seen that before.
That would be interesting, yeah.
And I'm pretty sure, yeah, that's a plausible scenario here, actually. And if it is Ken, I think he's being manipulated himself because, you know, initial scene, 02 kids getting obliterated.
I just had this great, this wandering imaginative thought where the guy, it turns out Ken's actually a Bakuman, or this Ken's actually a Bakuman, takes off the glasses and you see those horrifying eyes that all Bakuman have when they're disguised as humans.
Yeah.
But the thing is, too, that, you know, I mean, it's not outside the realm of possibility that this is just flat out a Digimon that happens to look like, you know, the Digimon Emperor. This could be Kaisermon that we've seen the birth of. Because Digimon doesn't really have any sort of consistency when it comes to Digivolution and how things work. Like, we see, going back to the punk rock Agumon and the reggae Palmon thing, like, people just accept that those are like, oh, yeah, those are totally, you know, actual Digimon.
Well, I think their exact words were, what a couple of weirdos.
Yeah, Chimeramon is something that exists. You can literally make up a Digimon.
With MetalGreymon's head.
With MetalGreymon's
head. I don't know, man. Maybe
Myotismon, grew himself some of MetalGreymon's hair, and that's how he became fab enough to become the front runner of Teenage Ramen.
See, we keep saying Myotismon, but there's another option here.
Daemon?
Devimon.
Chris got it.
Devimon?
Because look at the pattern. Quagamon shows up in the first part. Leomon and Ogremon show up, and they both are being dealt with, possession.
Okay.
Not to mention, we've already established that Devimon is still out there somewhere.
That's true. His data is still floating around in some sense.
Plus, the next teaser clearly shows TK and Patamon.
Yeah.
TK saying goodbye, or Patamon saying see you later to TK.
Hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I'm digging this.
Not going Myotismon route. If we've been following like the original, you know, run of the show, then we're probably dealing with Devimon here.
That's true. And Devimon would fit more into a punk metal band anyway.
Oh, Jesus fucking Christ.
God damn it!
Yeah, shit, man. You should see his ultimate form, Neo Devimon. It looks very punkish. Yeah.
He's like punk rock Batman or something. Evil punk rock Batman. Is that not what he looks like?
I'm not sure those claws will be able to shred on a guitar without shredding the guitar. But
so it's Palmon and Leomon are basically, or Palmon's basically in there all by herself.
Yeah, they go
Digimon
into
Emperor.
It's like what exactly is that place?
It looks like a world between. It's like the world between worlds.
It's like a rift, yeah.
Yeah.
Wait. It's the world between world, like on, like it's sort of between them, like, you know, the blade of a knife.
God fucking damn
it! It's the world on a knife.
God fucking.
That's where they're fighting.
Damn it!
They're fighting in the world on the knife.
One of you, please say something.
Tom.
What?
Do you want to get in on the beating up Andy?
I mean, I wouldn't say no to it.
See, and I'm the host of this podcast. Otherwise, I would have been kicked out long ago.
But not only is Ken there, but fucking Imperial German is there.
But in some sort of stasis, initially.
And not...
Hey, you remember when they had all those fond memories of Ogremon and kind of wanted to hold back because of that?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know how they didn't apply that at all to Imperial Dramon?
Yeah.
Yeah, but Imperial Dramon is a fucking mega.
And Imperial
we
Dramon
can't
is...
afford to pull our punches. He probably
yeah,
isn't
and Imperial
even feeling
Dramon, the... Imperial Dramon is also their friends. Like, not even just Ogremon as a casual companion. These are the Digimon of their friends. This now means that Wormmon has died an equal amount of times to Leomon.
Well,
okay.
This Leomon.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, if we're going Leomons, you know, Leomon's way up there.
Nowhere close.
Yeah, but Joe finally comes in.
He gets in the fucking robot.
Yeah. And it is beautiful. First off, I love the fact that Mimi and Joe's Digimon are the ones that show off the new Champion to Ultimate Evolution animation.
Champion to Ultimate, sorry.
Champion to Ultimate, yeah.
Because in Japanese version, the Mega form is called the Ultimate form, so...
Yeah,
they,
yeah.
Yeah, I got confused.
Yeah, because we didn't really show that. Because last time, MetalGreymon WereGurumon just showed up, and then they turned into WarGreymon MetalGurumon. And then they became Omnimon. But this time we actually see the animation for Champion to Ultimate.
Mm-hmm. And it's really cool. Like, it incorporates their crest symbol into the evolution, and that's really neat.
It's like,
yeah, I'd really
like it. And then Vikemon shows up, and I'm like, this guy looks like he's about to pillage an anus. He's about Imperial German's anus. Yeah.
I just can't think of what to say next, is all.
Yeah, no.
You really can't follow up anus pillaging.
Nope.
Yeah. But this one thing that I was kind of I found kind of fun because I like these sort of references and sources stuff happen in Digimon, and basically any property that uses, you know, companion monsters and evolutions and stuff. It's because when Lilymon started evolving to her mega form,
Rosemon, yeah.
And all the rose motifs were there. My initial reaction was, is that an Alrauna that she's turning into? And then she becomes Rosemon, and I'm like, yes, that is an Alrauna, which is basically a semi little known middle aged plant sex demon.
Interesting.
Well, her attack is Forbidden Temptation.
Yeah,
we've chosen to market Digimon as a child-friendly franchise.
Well, no. When they're referring to Forbidden Temptation, they're talking about the temptation to steal cookies from the cookie jar.
Chris, clearly. The temptation is the temptation of the titties.
I think it's the temptation.
Yeah, but no, since
those are massive, though.
Children, it's clearly the temptation to steal cookies from the cookie jar.
It's the last temptation of Christ.
Yeah, but I mean, as great as it was, as great as it was to see, you know, these two digivolving to their mega level.
About fucking time.
And now we're waiting for the, you know, other megas.
They just wrecked shop. Well, like, there was no point where it felt like they were in danger.
I mean, it was like, you'd think this is the first time we're seeing these in the series, and it's just like, huh.
I
guess they're just gonna digivolve because...
Well, I mean, it's a 2-on-1 mega.
Yeah, but so... is WarGreymon and MetalGreymon gets Piedmon the first time.
I'm not talking about the battle itself. I'm talking about the fact that they digivolve and that there was relatively little fanfare about it. There wasn't, like, a ton of build-up to it. It's just, okay, we've solved our problems, and now they can suddenly... You know, digivolve.
Yeah, I'm sure Ty was livid about the fact that they didn't have to be shot with an arrow.
Regarding the fact that they had relatively little, you know, trouble with defeating Imperial Dremon, it could have been that, you know, Imperial Dremon, due to being under the Digimon Emperor's control, wasn't in, you know, in full control of his combat faculties, even with the, you know, giant fuck of cannon blast in the end.
I was thinking it was more the fact that he was holding back, because at some part of him remembered, oh, these are my friends.
Are the... Well, again, one, so much for boasting that you're the strongest Digimon ever, Imperial Dremon.
Yeah, fucking shit.
God damn it, every time.
calm yourself. But... I don't know, maybe that isn't the Imperial Dremon we know and love. It may have just been a artificially made one.
Possible.
I know that sometimes it has a different color scheme because it's a corrupted evolution.
Yeah, but Imperial Dremon was always dark anyway, so.
Yeah, but...
Well, it didn't have the purple.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, and it had white bits, and those are kind of shaded now.
And the real question, too, is where exactly are Davis and Vimon and all
Yoli.
This.
Well, Vimon is part of Imperial Dremon.
Yeah, presumably. That's why you'd think that they'd need to be
together. Where's Davis?
The thing is,
what
we've established is that DNA digivolution requires the two digidestined to be in tune with each other. That's why...
Yeah.
You know, Alphamon, in the fight with Alphamon, Omegamon ended up breaking apart because Matt and Ty weren't in tune with each other and were having doubts, or at least Ty was having doubts.
Having doubts, yeah.
Although Stingmon can digivolve to Dinobeemon, which I think can digivolve to Imperial Dremon, so it could have been a forced direct one.
That's a possibility.
That's the first time I'm hearing of that. But I mean, as far as the continuity of this show has been.
Yeah.
Man, also, I'm never going to understand this digivolution bullshit.
No. And also, it's the fact that Ken was controlling Imperial Dremon. Like, a decade ago, he was having trouble controlling Greymon.
Oh, yeah, with, yeah.
And now he's suddenly controlling what is essentially two ultimates at once. Like...
You know what? This brings up another thing of bullshit with Digimon Zero 2. Greymon was able to digivolve to Metal Greymon without the help of any crest or any shit like that, thanks to Ken. Leomon can still digivolve without any thanks to a crest, so what's forcing... Yes, we're going back to Zero 2, because this is
with Leomon, I wanted to point out that Leomon could go to Mega because he got, you know, blasted with holy light a lot during the. Oh god.
That's a good point.
Shortly before the Devimon fight.
And Edamon?
Edamon is just, performing an Elvis concert somewhere.
Elvismon, or Elf.
Elvismon. he might as well be Elvismon, let's be honest here.
He was, in a different dimension, more or less. Yeah. So maybe the rules there are different. Look, the rule, Digimon's not about rules. It's kind of a just run with it franchise.
They're more like guidelines compared to actual rules.
God damn it, Tom.
Oh, fuck off.
Yeah, I'm one to talk.
Anywho, Vikemon and Rosemon save the day.
Village Imperial Jamon's anus.
And they get him back.
They get Makumon back.
Shit goes wrong.
Yeah.
Shit goes horribly, horribly wrong. And I actually had to watch that scene like 3 times to understand exactly what the fuck happened.
He was only a few moments away from retirement. And by retirement, I mean the next episode.
He was going to go back to his home village and get married.
Jesus Christ.
But basically, and I think that was actually part of the Digimon Emperor's plan here, that not even to, win, but to freak Makumon the fuck out.
What?
Yeah, because bad things seem to happen when Makumon gets overwhelmed.
Yeah.
I think that's why Himikawa found him, that's why Mei ended up finding him.
That's why everyone's trying to find him.
Because, in the first episode, when he was staring at that thing, but got with that big tower
her
thing. I don't know. Jap.
Makumon is
female. That whatever.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, her, sorry. When Makumon's just staring at that tower thing, she's starting to get overwhelmed. Kari noticed that something was off of her camera. Again, I think that bad things just seem to happen when Makumon gets overwhelmed.
And it was enough to turn a Digimon.
Was looking at the...
It was enough to turn a Digivice black?
Yeah. And Makumon was being held by Leomon, who just, a bit before was all scary berserk dude-like. So Makumon flips the fuck out, shanks Leomon to death.
No, he just shanks Leomon. It's like completely decapitates him and obliterates him. I mean, still not as shocking as what happened to Arcanemon and Mummymon, but...
Yeah.
Still one of those, what the fuck?
And gets the hell out of Dodge in a new, scarier form, but still somehow Makumon.
And that girl and that lady fucking smiles.
Himikawa, yeah.
She fucking smiles at that. What the fuck?
I'm not sure if there's an evil intention or just she's glad she knows who they're targeting now.
That's, but why the fuck?
That was an evil smile. When anime focuses just on someone, cracking a smile when, nobody else is in charge, literally on the mouth, it's more like I'm happy about, it's a secret that someone's secretly happy about something bad happening. It's usually this.
Yeah. I had to take a minute because I'm like, oh god, she is evil. On some level. Or maybe she just knows something that the rest of them don't. Maybe this was part of some other prophecy that Jedi found.
Maybe she is Jedi.
Okay, I know he got younger, but I don't think a sex change is really, something he was striving for.
Man.
Sometimes a guy just feels like he was born in the wrong body.
Now I kind of want to see Himikawa, but with Season 1 Jedi's voice.
The dub one or the sub voice?
The dub.
Either.
Oh, no, she shows up at the end, and after they've finally defeated, the DNA digivolution of Myotismon, a.k.a. Vandemon and Devimon, which is Van Devimon, of course.
Look, I don't think they're going to bring Myotismon back again.
Anyway, she shows up as, after they defeat them, and smirks and says, "Congratulations, Digidestin, but Van Devimon was not the true enemy."
The teenage German is the true enemy.
Anyway,
and then she styles her hair like Metal Greymon's.
Jesus Christ! God, you keep bringing up Myotismon. Like, I don't. They're not gonna do it. They're not gonna do that again.
They might.
They might.
They won't.
Depends on how good a writer they have.
I mean, he's been doing a pretty good job so far.
But maybe he's contractually obligated to show some in Myotismon.
We've already done the Myotismon thing. How many more evolutions of Myotismon are you gonna show?
I think Devimon is the better choice if they're going to go. Because know there's going to be, you know, at least one of those.
There's too many parallels to it. There's too many parallels.
Hey, we've already seen Devimon's Mega, so, yeah.
What's his Mega?
Daemon.
Oh, that's right. Daemon?
Well, that is true, because Daemon's also still out there. Yeah. So he could be a part of it. But we also, one last thing we should point out is we still need to point out the fact that this is the third one of the knights that have shown up.
The, Imperial German is, you mean?
Yeah, he's one of the
Well, Paladin mode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he's still a knight.
What are we missing? We're missing Magnamon and Dukemon.
He's not part of the circle, he's the founder.
Yeah. But we're making a lot of comparisons to the Royal Knights because we got Alphamon, Omegamon, we got Imperial German. Hackmon is a servant of the knights.
Are the Royal Knights even part of the adventure continuity, or?
I don't think so.
I don't have a lot of experience with who the knights are.
From what I've been informed by Chad, Hackmon was training under the Royal Knights to succeed one of them.
Hmm.
Yeah, but because the knights basically appear in Magnamon was one of them. Dukemon in Tamers was one of them.
We had Roto Knightmon or Crusadermon and Dynasmon in Frontier. Most of the Royal Knights showed up for Sabers.
Mm.
But it holds sense. We have three of the knights, a protege of the knights. Like, clearly, there's some kind of connection we're supposed to be making here with them.
Probably, yeah.
And
the thing with Hackmon too, though, I want to bring up is I'm probably way off on this because everyone else seems to be like, you know, not bringing this up at all when they talk about it, but to me it kind of looked like Hackmon, the way he was shown, it almost looked like maybe he evolved into Imperial German, but probably not.
Probably not.
No, like, his Mega is Jessmon.
Yeah, he's trained to take over for to become Jessmon.
But were he and Imperial German ever shown on screen at the same time?
Were he? No, but that's not. That's.
You know what? I'm just cutting that because obviously I'm wrong and dumb.
But okay. The thing about.
No, keep it up with the crazy talk.
But okay, so. But.
Okay.
The thing is, like, it does feel like there's that third element there.
What,
like,
third element?
A different. Like, I don't know. It feels like whatever's going on, like, it seems like there's two different villain sides here. Like the villains we've been seeing don't seem connected.
Yeah, two if not more.
Yeah, and yeah, with the thing with the knights is like knights are soldiers, and soldiers follow a leader.
Yeah,
and the leader of the knights is what is it? Yggdrasil?
Yeah, I think it was. Yeah.
So
I really need to do research into the knights again because I don't know all this.
Evolution was weird.
Chad ran me through the entire history after I watched after I watched this new part.
Yeah,
and he got me all caught up on it. And then I read up on it, so I'm kind of a decent amount of knowledge right now.
Yeah. Little admission, despite hosting a Digimon podcast, I am not intimately familiar with all the continuity of Digimon. I haven't even seen, you know, Cross Wars. I only watched the first three seasons when I was young. But this isn't a podcast for experts anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. This episode as a whole, it was like, it was really okay. It was really good in terms of character development.
Amazingly good at that, yeah.
Yeah, like it brought up what I'm assuming are going to be, you know, recurring themes and ideas. So in that sense, it was very good. The rest of it was more or less filler, which was, again, you know, it was enjoyable to watch because it was packed with all sorts of great fan service for us as fans.
I just like it because it feels like it's like they're just trying to live their lives, basically. Yeah.
But everything related to the plot,
it was just pretty much just a
that just raises further questions scenario.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'd be okay with all this filler if it was, you know, a weekly airing series, but when we're getting parts that are 4 to 6 months in gap...
Yeah, the next one's not until September.
Yeah.
September. It was supposed to be summer.
Yeah. Well, September's still summer anime season-wise.
Not here. September is going back to school.
All I can really do is say, well, I trust them to not screw this up and to at least explain some things.
Yeah, I think they will.
I think they will as well. I think the writing is going to be pretty...
I mean, clearly they're building to something big.
Yeah, they're building to something, and I think that in the later episodes, things are going to be a lot tighter. I think that they're taking some time now to explore and to sort of refamiliarize people with the world and the characters. I mean, like, it feels like there's a lot of filler, and it's slower paced now. I think that once we get past that, once we get into later movies, we're going to start seeing that, yes, this is going to be paced a lot more tightly, something where it's not going to, you know, in later movies, I don't think they're going to be taking a day off to go to the spa.
No, probably not.
They won't have the time.
That's important right now to establish things, and it's filler, but it's filler that is paced right and set up in a good way, and it's fun. And you need to have a little bit of that before you shoo out the clowns.
Basically, yeah.
And I think that they've done that by killing off Leomon, maybe.
Yeah, this might be the point, though, the turning point right here, because now Mikumon is doing something.
This is something we started at the beginning of the podcast because we said that we'd talk about this for, because according to the rules that we've been given, a Digimon that dies in the digital world just, you know, resets back to an egg.
But what happens in the real world? Yeah, because we saw Wizardmon.
Yeah, normally in the real world, the data is just supposed to float around and never find a place to go. That's how Myotismon ended up possessing Oikawa.
Yeah, and then Wizardmon became Wizardmon a ghost.
Kind of
Leomon had
that place.
Rift open, so I'm not sure where his data would go in this.
Yeah,
place.
It's gonna be interesting to see.
They could end up just giving us a new Leomon Mega go with Leomon just going.
No, because then they'll kill him off too.
That would set a new record, though, killing off Leomon twice within the same series.
Hey, man.
Well, they've killed off two different Leomons in a series.
Yeah.
But this would be the same one.
So something I just want to point out, one last follow-up point on the Knights thing, is that Yggdrasil is, from what I've been told, is basically the CPU for the entire digital world.
At least that server. Apparently there's a concept of different servers. Which have different digital
worlds. But if you look at it that way, that's basically like the god of the digital world, and Daemon is essentially the Lucifer. So by this speculation, we're essentially getting into a god versus devil situation.
Well, I mean, if we're going to compare a Digimon to Lucifer, why not make it Lucimon?
Well, Lucimon like doesn't have continuity.
He's not in the adventure continuity necessarily.
Actually, if Daemon exists, Lucimon might, because they're both part of the seven demon lords.
Yeah.
Oh, but, so I mean, it's like the opposites of the royal knights?
Basically?
Kind of, yeah. You got Beelzemon, Lilithmon, Daemon, Lucimon, Leviamon, Barbamon, and
Mephistomon? Wait.
So we've established we've already established Daemon exists.
Yeah.
And so, it's very possible that they'd be bringing him back, especially since he's an evolution of Devimon, who they've established is not completely gone.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's at the Dark Sea.
So this could be a situation of, like, I don't know.
And
like
we know God now, versus demon. We know now that 02 is not completely non-canon.
No, at least the kids exist.
At least the kids exist. At least the Digimon Emperor thing exists. In some form, maybe. I don't know if maybe things went differently in this world. Maybe it's an alternate continuity of the adventure.
I'm still banking on an alternate continuity.
It's possible yet.
Maybe, but as to what point, at what point where the divergent happens, I'm not certain.
Yeah, and do you think that there are any more plot threads from 02 that they might pick up? Do you think we're going to see anything of Dagomon or the Dark Ocean at all?
I mean, it would make sense, because now that we've got a Dark Digivice again, we'd kind of have to go back to the Dark Ocean.
We have to go back.
Oh, God damn it! God damn it, Tom.
Well, I don't know what I expected.
The Dark Seeds could be a thing still.
Well, I mean, they're still in the kids, apparently.
You had one job, Jedi. Yeah, the kids
could have, stopped following...
You had one fucking job.
Those kids could have stopped, following the dream.
Well, yeah, we got a possible Daemon, we've got a possible Dagomon, Dark Ocean, we got a possible literal God versus Lucifer, like, God versus Satan. We've got, evil knights, we've got the return of Digimon Hitler. I guess we could throw in Myotismon at some point.
Because
that vampiric fuck doesn't seem to want to die.
With MetalGreymon's hair.
You know what? Why stop there?
MetalGreymon's hair is the enemy behind everything in this series.
Edamon will be the true villain.
No, you know what? Why even stop there? If we're really banking on an apocalyptic scenario here, let's just bring Apocalypmon back.
He has an evolved form. Two, actually.
Isn't he already a mega?
He has a side form, apparently. Well, at least in the Tamer's canon. When Apocalypmon got deleted, he reverted back to his original form, which was the ultimate Mephistomon, who then becomes Goldmon.
Mephisto.
Yeah.
And then he went and fucked up Spider-Man's marriage.
God damn it!
But, or you know what? Why even stop that? Let's just bring in Millenniummon. Give him a proper anime appearance.
Well, technically he did. It was just him getting killed.
Yeah.
Let's bring back all the villains.
Well, let's think about Millenniummon, because that was Ken and Ryo's arc.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, and now Ken is possessed, potentially?
Or that could be someone else.
Or it could be someone else, yes. Anyway.
And at this point, Tom, you know who could it could be? Although, no, it couldn't, but I would laugh if they actually did it. They could put Davis in there.
I'd be lying if I said it didn't heavily cross my mind.
Sick and tired of being the butt monkey.
You... TK stole my girl for the last time.
They
fuck you,
what happens is they put a dark seed in him, and suddenly he realizes, wait a minute, running a noodle cart is a fucking stupid dream. I'm gonna turn evil now.
But here's the big question. Did they put Ken's dark seed in him?
Yes, because as we already stated,
I'm just letting that hang
Digimon
there.
Adventure Tri Part
Ken
2 is gay.
I'm just letting that hang there. But yeah, I mean, there's so many different, like, Chad and I went over this, like, heavily in detail, like, all the different scenarios that could run here. Like, we could bring back old foes in the original, we could bring back stuff that has only existed outside of the main television series.
like, it's gonna be interesting.
I actually wouldn't. You know what I would like, but it's highly unlikely.
Yeah.
Beelzebumon cameo.
Beelzebumon.
Yeah.
But it's tamer design, not that shitty Cross Wars design.
So I guess any final thoughts on all this?
Could have been a little less fluff filled. But again, I appreciate the character moments. So happy to see Vikemon.
I've seen Rosemont too.
I had fun watching it. I'm really invested in what happens next. I only wish that it was going to happen goddamn sooner.
Yeah, that's a definite.
That about sums up my thoughts as well. Only thing I would add
is... I'll just say this. You have 6 months. Do not give us another scene like that cheerleading
one. I think we're past that point now. I think we kind of...
Well, no, I mean just the way it was animated. Don't give
us God, yeah.
Point.
Fuck yeah. No, absolutely.
I'm just hoping that they continue with the great character stuff that they're doing, because like we keep coming back to this statement, but Digimon has really great characters and does some really great character development, and I think Tribe may be some of the best of it, with the exception of maybe Tamers.
Yeah, no, it's definitely shaping up that way.
So especially since it's so much more relatable, the struggles that they're going through now.
Well, I think it's relatable more to us now because we were at that age. Like these kids grew up with us.
Yeah,
exactly. Like they grew up just like we did.
Yeah, it's kind of like Toy Story 3, where hopefully the kids won't end up in a trash compactor. But
like a baby every time.
It's like, you know, so many reboots, it's just like, oh, it's, you know, what it was when I was a kid. But no, it's just like, they're, while we were growing up and having our adventures, they were doing the exact same thing.
Yeah, it's the same, only it's different.
Which is what Ty said in the first episode. It's like, I see, well, no, it's like, I know more but understand less or something. God damn it, why did I fuck that up?
Yeah.
I see more but understand less.
Yeah, I think that was it.
All right. Well, I think that'll wrap it up for now.
Alrighty.
So, until next time. Actually, you guys want to go first? I'll take what you guys don't take for the sign off.
Long live Leomon.
Sorry, but no.
Until next time, I'm Buggy, and if anyone out there is great with Photoshop or art, I want you to draw every single villain in the series with MetalGreymon's hair.
Yes.
I'm Maddie, and I'm going back to watching anime out of spite.
I'm Chris, and I just want some snacks.
Ayo shopping.
None of you are going to make references to Devimon or Vandemon. Not going to go with any of that. Not the changing band names.
No.
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 Come
no.
on, guy.
That joke just...
God damn it, no.
That joke is deader than Leomon.
Oh my god.
Okay, you guys aren't giving me too much funny material for this end to work.
you wouldn't do anything good with it anyway.
Good night, everybody.
Bye, guys.
See you in September.
Yep.
Yeah.
This ending's gonna be a fucking horrid thing to edit.
I think that was Nishikawa that Mei saw that Sora threw the tub over.
It was who?
Nishikawa.
Oh, possibly. I don't know. We're not going back and checking.
Oh, I mean, I got it up right now, so.
Oh, you do, don't you?
Are you watching the episode as we're?
It was just sort of running.
Oh.
So he's watching the episode and he's got it up.
Oh, you son of a bitch.
I get it.
I don't.
It's okay. Give it some time, Tom. Give it some time.
Why doesn't Tom ever get the jokes?
No, never do.
Maybe it's a way to protect his sanity.
I mean, isn't prostitution legal over there? Like,
don't get me started on talking on Polish prostitution laws. It's a black. There could be a whole you know other podcast about it. But Hooters isn't prostitution. It's just.
No.
As far as I understand, it's a fast food restaurant with a sexy dress code.
Basically.
And busty servers.
Hooters is an escort service without the flag.
Welcome to the Digicast, where we talk about
Polish prostitution laws.
I can just hear Andy saying that with his head in his palms.
We went completely off track. Like, completely.
That was the worst fucking segue we have ever taken.
Remember, there's supposed to be like 4 of these coming, and we're still going to do the movies and Tamer. We can do worse.
You okay there, Tom?
We're so
prepared for help. My stomach hurts.